In this video, we are now going to talk about how we can improve the k-nearest neighbors algorithm using certain modifications and also considering certain hyperparameters. So in the previous video, we talked about a priority queue, which is basically a data structure that we use to make k-nearest neighbors more efficient. So we use the priority queue to avoid searching the whole training set every time when we looked for a new neighbor. So here, another way to make the performance of the computational performance of k-nearest neighbors more efficient is using space partitioning data structures. The heap was technically also a space partitioning data structures to speed up the sweep over the training examples themselves. So in that way, we maybe can avoid making a distance computation for every training data set point. If we can divide the data set up front into a space partitioning data structure. So for example, one simple technique for doing that would be bucketing. So again, this is something that we do up front now. The priority queue is something we would run at prediction time, but we are talking now about data structures during training. So in that way, k-nearest neighbors won't be as lazy as before. So it's not just storing the data points, it's also partitioning the data set during training. So in bucketing, for example, if we have again our simple data set with two features, x1 and x2, we could think of a way of dividing the data set into subsets or into buckets. So we can make, for example, equally sized buckets, maybe like this. And if we know the location or the features for each bucket, so the feature measurements, the boundaries for each bucket, then we can avoid searching the whole training set for every query point. So for example, if I have a query point located here, it would maybe make sense to only search points within this bucket. I wouldn't have to search points that are, let's say, over here, right? So in that way, I can actually eliminate all these data points here in my training set if I'm interested in the question mark, for example. So in that way, that is one way we can make the search more efficient. There are more sophisticated ways of doing that. One is, for example, called KD tree. This makes also relatively similar hypercubes, similar to bucketing. It will look a little bit different. It will look a little bit like this, where we divide it up like this. And this is a very efficient approach for dealing with that substructuring. We don't need to go into too much detail about KD trees. That's really a computer science topic. We don't need to know all the details about all the data structures here. It's just like here about the main concept that we can partition the search space here. Another one that is very common is the so-called ball tree. It's more like an algorithm for making spherical buckets. Instead of these hypercubes, we make hyperspheres to divide the data set. And which one to use really depends. So if we have a large number of features, the ball tree would be, for example, be preferred over a KD tree. There is a tool that we will be using in this class pretty heavily. It's called scikit-learn, machine learning library. And this library has a setting for the k-nearest neighbor classifier. It's called, so you don't have to memorize this, it's called algorithm. And in the algorithm setting for the k-nearest neighbor classifier, there are different options you can set. By default, it's set to auto. And that means that the tool, the machine learning tool, will automatically, based on your training set, decide which one to use, which space partitioning algorithm to use. You can override the setting by providing options like KD tree or ball tree manually, but usually there's no need. The algorithm has been written in a way that they will automatically choose the one that is most efficient for a given training set. There's also an option called brute, which is basically a brute force search. And this brute force approach would be the naive k-nearest neighbor implementation that we talked about earlier, the what we called a variant A earlier in the previous video. Another approach to making k-nearest neighbors more efficient is using dimensionality reduction. So dimensionality reduction comes in two flavors. There is a feature extraction. It's usually involving involving linear transformations of features or nonlinear transformation of features, squishing them onto a lower dimensional space. We'll talk way more about that later in this course. And another flavor is a feature selection. So for example, again, the main difference is if I have, let's say, three features, x1, x2, x3, feature extraction may combine them in a way that we have a new feature z1 and z2, for example, or just z1. And feature selection would take one of these features, so it doesn't make a new feature. It doesn't combine these features or transforms these features. It's just selecting one. For example, we may select x1 and x3. So in that way, we just reduce the number of features that we use. And why does it make k-nearest neighbor more efficient? It's because we have a cheaper distance computation, right? If you think of the Euclidean distance, if you have fewer features, we have fewer things to compute in the Euclidean distance. So that might be another way to make k-nearest neighbors slightly more efficient. And there's also something called the curse of dimensionality. And this is usually a big problem in machine learning. When we have a large number of dimensions, there's a problem usually that the generalization performance, that means how well the algorithm will perform on new data. So with the curse of the dimensionality, that means the more features we have, usually the worse the generalization performance becomes. And that is usually due to overfitting. So because in a high dimensional space, everything is pretty far away compared to a lower dimensional space. I have a more concrete example with some numbers about that in the course notes. But again, we don't need to go into too much detail here in the lecture notes. So I recommend anyways that you read the course notes where I give an example for the curse of dimensionality. Here we can also improve the computational performance of k-nearest neighbors by editing or pruning. So pruning or editing simply means that we are editing out or removing data points from the training set, but we remove them in such a way that they won't affect the decision boundary if they are removed. And to show you an example of what that means, have a look at these plots here. So on the left hand side, what I'm showing you is a plot, a scatter plot again with two feature axes, x1 and x2. And I have two classes, these circles and these diamonds. And you can see, for example, if we would have a new data point somewhere, let's say, located on this end here, and we want to classify that, and we would consider the nearest neighbors, assume for this purpose we have a k-nearest neighbor model with k equals 3 or larger, what would happen is we would find, for example, these three neighbors here. And even though we have the diamond here, it will never really do anything because per majority vote, we also have these two circles here, right? So in that way, really, this is kind of not necessary to have it here because it will never really change the decision boundary because we always consider three neighbors and there will always be two circles in the neighborhood here. So what we can do is we can just get rid of this point here. So we can remove this. And similarly, we can also remove this point here at the lower left corner. So what happens then basically is that we, if we have any point here in this region as shown on the right, these will still be classified the same way as if these diamonds were included. So there's just a way we can make the computation more efficient because we have fewer comparisons, fewer distance computations when we look for the k-nearest neighbors and the class label. A concept that is somewhat related to the editing and pruning is creating prototypes. So with that, I mean replacing a dense region of training data points with a single data point. So for example, if I have a data set like this again, I have my two features, x1 and x2, and I have a lot of data points over here, the training set. Really dense region, and again I have maybe a really dense region here. So these are two classes, two different classes, the red and the green ones. Can maybe just use colors. What I can do is I can replace these points by bigger points. So if I have a k nearest neighbor model with k equals 3, I don't really have to have all these points around here, because if I have a new data point that falls in here somewhere, I don't really have to have all these points here, right? So what I can do is I can replace them by a few number of prototypes. So I can get rid of these points, for example, and put some bigger points here. Let's call them the prototype points, something like that. And even though I have these points, way fewer points than before, I would still get the same classification, right? Because if a point is over here where the question mark is, if I consider the three nearest neighbors, let's say this would be these ones, it would be still the circle class, the red dot here. And similarly, I could also replace on the right-hand side these green dots by fewer prototypes. I really don't have to have all of them around. And again, by having fewer training examples, I will speed up the computation, of course, because I have fewer comparisons to make. Another aspect next to having this algorithm running more quickly in a prediction task, another advantage of having these prototypes is also that it will require less storage space. So it's also space advantage that we don't need to have a large, let's say, storage space requirement. Now, if we have a data set of billions of data points, we can maybe reduce it to thousands of data points and can save up on a lot of storage space. Now, another topic is improving the predictive performance. Before we talked about the computational performance, making it run faster, what about making it perform better, having a better prediction accuracy? It's also an important consideration in practice, of course, because we not only care about having a fast algorithm, but also about a very accurate algorithm. Otherwise, it wouldn't be useful in practice usually. Yeah, machine learning algorithms come with a lot of settings, lots of options that we can choose when we run these algorithms. And these options are also called hyperparameters, because they're not really parameters that we fit, so they are not really extracted from the training data. These are so-called hyperparameters. Hyperparameters are, you can think of them as tuning options or algorithm settings. This is usually something the algorithm doesn't learn by itself. It's something you as the user would play around with and then see if it can make the algorithm perform better than with another setting. We will talk a lot about this in the model evaluation lectures, that we will see how we can do that properly without overfitting. But for now, let's just consider we have different options, and by these or using these options and setting different values for these options, we can also make a better KNN model, a better k-nearest neighbor model. So yeah, what are these different options? So there is, of course, the value of k, the number of k-nearest neighbors to consider. There's, of course, no solution to every type of data set, but usually you would try different values, for example, 3, 5, 7, 10, 15, 20, and so forth, and see what performs better. As a rule of thumb, the larger k is, the smoother the decision boundary will be, and the smaller the k is, of course, the noisier the decision boundary will be. If you have a binary data set, it would make sense to use values like k equals 3 or k equals 5, like odd values, because if you have a binary data set, this way you will never get a tie. If you use, for example, k equals 2 or k equals 4, you can get a tie where you have, let's say, two labels for class 0 and two labels for class 1, and then it's basically a random decision which prediction you make. And I don't like randomness if it can be avoided, so I would usually choose an odd number if I have a binary classification data set. Another hyperparameter that we talked about earlier in lecture 2 was the scale of the feature axes. Sometimes it's desired to have features on the different axes because then we can maybe incorporate some domain knowledge and say one feature is way more important than another feature, so we can also affect the decision boundary by scaling these features. So that's also one hyperparameter. Unless though you have some domain knowledge or some specific reason to change the feature axes, I wouldn't touch them. It's more like usually I would just make sure they are on the same scale, but then you can maybe experiment with tweaking these axes a little bit. Another hyperparameter would be the distance measure. So we talked about choosing different distance measures like the Euclidean distance, the Manhattan distance, and so forth, or the cosine similarity. So in that way, these options are also available, and depending on the problem at hand, one distance metric may perform better than the other. Lastly, we can also introduce a weighting term in the distance measure computation, and it is somewhat related to scaling the feature axes, but sometimes it's just more elegant to add this weighting term in the feature distance computation. So in this video I'm showing you the decision regions of three different k-nearest neighbor models and for different values of k. So my question would be, can you guess which k value corresponds to which plot? Again, we have two features, x1 and x2, and we have two classes. It's a binary problem, so we have these squares and the triangles. So maybe take a few moments to think about it. Which k value corresponds to which plot? So if you paid attention to the previous slide, what I said is that usually the smaller k is, the noisier the decision boundary is. So in this way, we would have the noisier one here, k equals 1. You can see that in particular, if we look at certain examples, you can see there's a boundary around these individual points. So that can only be k equals 1, right? Because if we have k equals 3, we wouldn't observe something like that. For k equals 3, for example, we see that this point here, it's again the same point, it doesn't really influence the decision boundary anymore because there are always two or more triangles around it. And again, this is coming back to the editing or pruning slide that I talked about earlier. Sometimes it makes sense just to remove data points because they don't really influence the decision boundary anyway, and it's just a waste of time to include them in the training set. So here, this would be actually corresponding to k equals 3, and the smoothest decision boundary would be this one, k equals 7. So you can see, for example, here these two triangles influence the decision boundary because for k equals 3, these two ones outweigh the square next to it. But here it's not longer true because we have a lot of squares around this region, so these two triangles don't really do anything anymore. So we can also do the feature weighting via the Euclidean distance. So recall the Euclidean distance, this would be this whole thing here. We can also insert a weight wj here. If we have all the weights equal to 1, that would be like the regular Euclidean distance. But we can also include a weight here. So for example, if I have wj2, so the second feature, if I set that to 2, this would be equal to scaling the second feature by a factor of 2. So it's in that sense equivalent to feature scaling, so we don't really have to modify the distance measure. We can also scale the features up front. It's just a different way of doing it. And here at the bottom, I just show you how you can do that more efficiently using a dot product or doing linear algebra. So what I'm showing you here is so this part should be equivalent to computing the regular Euclidean distance. So for example, we would subtract the two vectors, so vector A and B are the feature vectors corresponding to training examples A and B. Maybe let's do a spontaneous example here. If I have vector A, let's say 1, 2, 3, and a vector B, so XB, just write B for space reasons, let's just do 2, 3, 4, then A minus B would be C equals minus 1, minus 1, minus 1, right? And the transpose, C transpose C, that would be minus 1 times minus 1 plus, minus 1 minus 1 is 1 plus, again, minus 1 times minus 1 is again 1 plus minus 1 times minus 1 is again 1, which is 3. So C transpose C is 3. And then the square root would be square root of 3. We can then insert the weight that we had up here using a matrix, a diagonal matrix. So in this diagonal matrix, why do we have space here? In this diagonal matrix, I would put the weights W1, W2, W3 if I have a three-dimensional vector in the diagonal. And then I can express this more efficiently because, linear algebra computations in Python are just more efficient than writing a for loop because the sum symbol would usually translate to a for loop in Python. And next lecture, we will see how we can use NumPy to do the dot products. So maybe just to compute the or complete the computation here, if I have my W, and let's just use values, 1, 2, 3 here for these weights. I can do it either way, right? I can compute this first or this first, doesn't matter. Let's just compute this one first. So what we do is we compute C transpose W, C is minus 1, minus 1, minus 1. So minus 1 times 1 plus minus 1 times 0 plus minus 1 times 0. That should be minus 1, right? So let me write this down here. Minus 1. And then for the second row, 0 times minus 1, 2 times minus 1, 0 times minus 1, that is minus 2. For the third one, 0 times minus 1 plus 0 times minus 1 plus 3 times minus 1, that should be minus 3, right? So this is our vector C transpose W, and then we multiply it by the vector C again. So minus 1 times minus 1 is 1. Let me put it here on the top. Plus minus 2 times minus 1 is 2. Plus minus 3 times minus 1 is 3. So the result is 6. That's the result of C transpose W C transpose W with the dot product C, that is this value, and if I would take the square root, this would be square root of 6. So yeah, there's just a more efficient way than, let's say, using this sum, but if that didn't make any sense, don't worry about it. We will talk more about NumPy linear algebra in the next lecture and why that is faster. I was just rambling here on how we can do the feature weighting more efficiently compared to using the for loop in Python. Just a quick clarification. I didn't want to interrupt my own train of thought here on this example, but I just noticed while I was writing this that there's a square root missing. So if we want to have the feature weighted Euclidean distance, we would have a square root there. Without the square root, we have the feature weighted squared Euclidean distance. In practice, it doesn't really make a difference, but whether we use squared or the regular Euclidean distance, but just to make this example consistent with what we have above here, we have to have a square root here. Another flavor of KNN is the distance weighted KNN. How does that work? I hope you remember this equation here. This is the mode. It's just a fancy way of writing the mode. This is for determining the class label during prediction, so basically the majority vote. Here, this is why we wrote it in a fancy way in the previous slide, because we can then also insert a weight here. Note that compared to the feature-weighted Euclidean distance, this weight is not for the feature, but for the training example, I. So what does it do? Maybe to give you a more intuitive example than this equation here, consider we have a data point that we want to classify, and then we have the, let's say, five nearest neighbors around it. Say we have this triangle here, this triangle here, and this triangle here, and then two circles very close by. So these would be my five nearest neighbors that I would consider for the majority vote. Using a regular normal KNN, what we would assign here as the class label would be the triangle, right? Because we have three triangles and only two circles. However, if we use the distant weighted KNN, we may even prefer these circles here, right? Because what we do is we weight the distance. So with, I mean, the distance between each training data point and the actual query data point. And we can have a different weight for how heavily we weight the distance. There's a common way to do that. It's like the squared distance here, 1 over the squared distance between the query data point. I call it T here. That's the data point here in the center and the given training data point. But yeah, again, this is just an arbitrary hyperparameter. There may be different options you could consider. Practice, sometimes people also add a small value here. Let's call it epsilon, I don't know, like some very small value, like 0.00001, for example. Just some small value to avoid a zero division error if we have a data point that is exactly the same. Of course, this again depends on many factors. Also depends on what we choose as the distance metric. So we can use also the Euclidean distance metric if we use the Euclidean distance metric to find the nearest neighbors, which would be the most intuitive way. But again, this is another hyperparameter. We are really free to choose any distance metric that we would like to use. So yeah, there are many, many hyperparameters when we talk about nearest neighbors. Okay, so that's it about improving nearest neighbors. And yeah, next lecture we will talk about k-nearest neighbors in Python.